Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Welcome to the First United Methodist Church here in Medford. We appreciate your attendance and welcome those who are visiting and those who are checking us out so they can come back next week. Hey, a few announcements. We have Pastor Ben is with a group of congregational members who are attending a outdoor camp training in Sisters, Oregon, at Sutter Lake. So when they come back, they'll tell us all about how to do things right, I guess. Also, if you read the bulletin, there is going to be a potluck at the on the 14th of April at Camp Let Go. So bring your favorite dish.
No, it's here.
I was wrong. Okay, it includes the people who are working there to come and enjoy fellowship with us. Linda, do you have something with the food?
No, not with food, with rubbish sale. Rubbish sale's coming. It's going to be the Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, May 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. If you have stuff to bring, to donate, bring it on Tuesday, starting at 9. Ken will have the pickup available if you need stuff brought from your house. There's some limited storage. Lavelle has some limited storage. You have to negotiate with her if you have something that needs to come out of your house now. And the circles will receive lists so that circle members can volunteer to work Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday.
Anyone can volunteer.
Anyone can volunteer, yeah, but specifically the circles. And then on Saturday, of course, is the giveaway, and we give everything away to the community. And we will have the Boy Scouts helping us set up tables and taking down tables. So find all your stuff.
So,
thank you. We're going to be starting up hiking again through the summer every few weeks or once a month. If you're interested or you know somebody that would like to come with us, let me know and I can get them on an email list so that they're updated. We're planning on going this coming Friday the 12th, but now it looks like it's going to rain, but we'll see. Of course, Thursday is nice and Saturday is supposed to be nice, but not Friday. So anyway, I'll keep you posted. If it's really bad, we won't go, but we'll probably go if it's cloudy or sprinkling a little bit. So anyway, have somebody talk to me if they're interested.
Hey everybody, this is Chris with the scout troop at the church. Just a reminder that Friday afternoon and evening we have a spaghetti fundraiser dinner here at the church. So you're welcome to come, especially if you're going to run in the Pear Blossom Run the next day. Get those carbs. So we're going to have spaghetti and meat sauce and regular sauce without meat and salad. So anyone's welcome to come. Probably around 5, 6 o'clock I think is when we're going to be doing it. Thanks.
I have one more. This month for the food pantry is box cereal. Box cereal. We give those out in every bag. And Dollar Tree has good cereal. And what's the other one?
Grocery Outlet.
Grocery Outlet has, it's about $1.50. So those are the places that are cheap.
Thank you for all the announcements, and I say the best for last tonight. Today, we will have Linda Bergeron as our guest speaker. So we welcome you, Linda.
Thank you.
And as we prepare to set our hearts, as we listen to a prelude, music.
Thank you.
Jolly Rancher?
Yes.
All right. Do you know what it's for?
No.
To eat. thank you. At this time, again, we want to welcome our guests and members of our church as your worship. Please turn with me to hymn 304.
Greeting.
All right, folks, join with me as we have our greeting and repeat Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Darkness has been vanquished.
The brilliant light of hope has come.
Come, let us worship and celebrate the good news.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen. Amen.
Amen. At this time, please turn to hymn 304, United Methodist Hymnal.
Thank you.
little sharing and welcome with each other. This is awesome to see us communicating, talking, hugging, wishing each other love and prayer. At this time, we have a hymn that's Agnus Dei by Michael W. Smith. But Smith is not here today, so we have a couple of folks that will be doing the gig. There you go, Jeff.
Emily is in her late 20s, and She leaves tonight or tomorrow. She's got a tumor on her brain stem. She's got a 6-year-old daughter and a husband. And she's going to Mayo Clinic in Arizona to a surgeon that's well known in operating on this type of tumor. You have to be accepted by him, and she was. So prayers for Emily and Elena and her husband, safe travels, and she won't find out for 2 weeks if it's cancerous. So it's going to be a hard time for this little family.
What did you say her name is?
Emily.
Emily? Emily and her family.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, I see a hand.
Yeah, for travel mercies for people on the road. My son on his way to Texas.
All right, travel mercies. Well, for Ben and the folks who are going to be returning from the training later today.
Yes.
Here's for my mother, Jackie Jones, who's in the hospital and recovering from a fracture of her hip.
I'm sorry, Dennis. I didn't catch the name. Someone recovering from a fracture.
Jackie Jones.
Jackie Jones. Okay, thank you. Yes.
A family friend, Mallory Goodwill. She's got less than 6 months to go.
Oh my. Did you say it's Ellery?
Valerie.
Valerie.
She has pancreatic cancer.
Mm. Pancreatic cancer. She has approximately 6 months to live. So for friends and family and for all who are involved in taking care of her and for her, for Valerie. Oh, there's another hand. Yes.
First for Ann Fuller. She is sick with some sort of, she thought it was just a sinus infection. That's why she's not here today. She's not quite sure what this is. She was feeling awful yesterday. It was supposed to bring me to church when my neighbor was not here.
Okay, that's for Ann.
Ann Fuller, yeah. Okay.
All right, thank you. Yes, in the back and then in the front.
My sister Jean, she just had an operation, and they were going to put a stent in her, but they can't because her vein is too small. Mm-hmm. So she goes home, and the doctor just told her to live and enjoy as much as she can.
As a celebration, Kathy is able to be with us today.
Yes. Kathy is recovering well enough to be here today. Yes.
Yes. My brother-in-law, whom I've mentioned in the past, is now on hospice. Mm. And his request and the family is that he will spend his time at home. So my sister is, she is a nurse, but boy, it's really pushing her to the brink.
Yeah.
She's doing well.
Mm-hmm. We'll continue to keep them in prayer. Yes.
Yeah. There's a nice fella named Sheldon who comes in to the pantry, and we all know him really well. Well, he has his wife who is dying of cancer. Mm-hmm. And there has been some problems, but they put him and his wife in a hotel. And hopefully hospice will take care of him. But the wife's name, I think, is Teresa. Teresa.
Sheldon and
so
Teresa.
Sheldon and Teresa. Yeah, need our prayers.
This is a guy that I met on the, when the police blotter comes on. This has been about 4 or 5 years ago, and he responded to something that I said, and every once in a while we'll make contact, and I've never met him, and I, you know, periodically think, oh, I wonder how so-and-so's doing, and then I'll make a note, well, about a week ago, he said that everything in his life has collapsed. He lost his wife, he's about to lose his home, he lost his dog, and they just discovered three areas of cancer in his colon. And he said that he was done, he just was ready to go. And I said, you know, was trying to say encouraging words and stuff, and then I finally contacted him a few nights ago and said, well, what happened, what's going on? And he came back last night and said they went in, they got all three of the places of cancer, they've already checked it, there's no cancer left. And I hate to even say this, because I always pray thinking, oh yeah, but God's not going to fix this, you know, whatever it is, you know, because it always seems impossible to me. And so last night was kind of a, are you kidding? See, I did take care of it. And I had to really think about it, and I'll have to think about it some more, but I'm grateful for this guy, and I would like for you to pray for him. I'm not going to tell you his name, because I can't remember it. That's because we really don't know each other. But anyway, I'm so grateful, and I just hope that his life turns around and he can feel like he can start walking in a positive direction now. Thank you.
Thank you for that testimony of God's answering prayer, sometimes very directly.
Yes.
Many times, not so much. Sometimes.
Yeah.
And often, we are the ones who need to know that. The person we're praying for, you know, yes, that's wonderful. Sometimes, we are the ones who need to.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that is a plateful, isn't it? Well, let's go before the Lord in prayer. Our gracious and holy God, we give you praise and thanks for the gift of prayer. We praise and thank you, Lord God, that we know that you hear our prayers, whether they are spoken or unspoken. And you know, Lord, that there are days when we have both joy and sorrow in our hearts. And we know that you recognize both of those, and we thank you for it. We thank you, Lord God, for your presence with us today. And we ask that you will be present with all those whose names have been lifted up this morning. For those who are traveling, for those who are dealing with chronic illnesses, life-ending illnesses, surgery. We lift them all to you, Lord God, trusting that you will be present in their lives and in the lives of those who care for them. We thank you, Lord God, for the blessings of answered prayer. We thank you for how it reminds us that you are there and you are responding, but sometimes in a very direct way. We thank you for that. Lord, in our world today, there's a lot of stuff going on, and sometimes the negative seems to overwhelm the positive. And yet we are grateful, Lord, for the gift of life, the gift of breath, the gift of family and friends. And as we are grateful for all of that, we are also mindful of folks who do not have the blessings that we have, for those who are unhoused. We pray for them, for all of them, Lord. We pray for those who are suffering the effects of war, especially the children and the women. We pray, Lord God, for our leaders at every level, from the local to the global. And we ask, Lord God, that your presence will be with them, that for those who know you, that they will be bold and courageous in speaking out, and that those who do not know you will come to know you. We pray, Lord, for peace in our world. We pray for the end of war and famine and disaster. We pray that your spirit will blow across this land and around the globe, bringing revival and renewal to all who are touched. We thank you, Lord God, most of all for the gift prayer that you gave us as we say together,
Our Creator in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our needs, create today, and forgive us our offenses, as we have forgiven our sins. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Yeah, I just want to give a shout out right now to Jeff and Anna Christina for their musical talents and sharing with us. Thank you very much. And now let us prepare our hearts as we share our gifts for his service.
As the Father has sent me, so I send you.
When he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. Amen.
Thank you, Renee. At this time, the choir can come up.
Before we introduce this new song, I want all of you to remember that the song that is your favorite song now, there was a time you didn't know it, you had to learn it. You never know. So this is a song that nobody in the choir, including me, had ever heard before. So we're going to sing the refrain with you listening to it, then we're going to sing the refrain again. It begins and ends with refrain. For those of you that read music and like to follow along in the faith we sing, it's 2206.
Without seeing you, we
There I am, all right. Okay, so I already know the answer to this question. If I say Christ is risen, you're going to say?
He is risen indeed.
So anytime today that you hear me say Christ is risen, you are going to say?
Christ is risen indeed.
All right, knock, knock.
Who's there?
Who's there?
Theodore.
Theodore who?
Theodore was open, so I came in. Knock, knock.
Who's there? To get to them. The priests would come down, they would tell jokes, they would tell stories, they would sing silly songs. I tried to convince Pastor Ben to do a silly song to introduce the sermon, but, you know, for whatever reason he couldn't find one, or maybe thought that was a little too far out. After these services, the people would gather together, they would tell jokes, they would play tricks on each other, they would have all kinds of fun after the service. The thing about Holy Humor Sunday is that it gives us an opportunity to continue celebrating the greatest miracle in human history, Jesus' resurrection. Jesus' resurrection gives us the opportunity to celebrate our God-given gift of laughter. We are the only creatures created that have the gift of laughter. Unless you've ever heard a hyena, maybe that qualifies, well, I don't think so. Anyway, I think it's a good thing that we have laughter, because honestly, don't we sometimes take ourselves way too seriously? So it was discovered that Lena was using the following password on her computer. Mickey, Minnie, Pluto, Louie, Dewey, Donald, Goofy, Sacramento. When asked why she had such a long password, she said it was because she had been told that she needed 8 characters and 1 capital. Eternity has the final laugh. Just
picture these guys, Caiaphas, Pilate, Herod, all of the men who worked together to kill Jesus, to end his time on earth, sitting around all grave and dignified, kind of patting themselves on the back for a job well done. That dangerous man is dead now, we can go back to things as normal. But behind their backs, what was happening? Without them knowing, without them having the slightest inkling of what was going on, the man they believed dead was alive and well and making himself known. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
There we go. The resurrection is the supreme joke, the final, ultimate joke played on these self-satisfied men. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
There once was a message on the outside of Faith Temple Church in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. It said, "We welcome all denominations. $1, $5, $10. By the way, what kind of man was Boaz, you know, the guy that married Ruth, before he married her? Ruthless. Which Bible character had no parents? Joshua, son of Nun. Okay, one more. Oh, I like this one. What do they call pastors in Germany? German shepherds. I went online, there were millions of them, I could get, but anyway. Some people think, and hopefully you're not one of them right now, that Holy Humor Sunday is only about cheap laughs or poor puns. But it is much more than that. Humor can bring healing. One story of Holy Humor healing was told by the pastor of what had often been called an ill-natured, divided congregation that was in turmoil. For several years, the pastor had tried without success to bring the various squabbling cliques together. With nothing left to lose, the pastor decided to have a Holy Humor Sunday, the Sunday after Easter. The service was filled with joyful songs, hymns, and inspiring scripture readings, celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. Members were encouraged to tell their favorite jokes. Practical jokes were played on the pastor and others. Joy and laughter filled the air. The entire congregation was focused on celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. The service brought everyone together in the spirit of goodwill and camaraderie. The response was overwhelmingly positive. The congregation was able to come and worship and just let go for an hour. And they realized that it was possible to come to church and feel good about their faith and each other. People, the pastor reported, talked about the service all week. Tensions between peoples and groups decreased. Disagreements were set aside as people focused on what they had in common, belief in the risen Lord. In addition, some who had said they intended to leave the church decided to stay. The Holy Humor service, the pastor continued, was just what the doctor ordered for our church. It provided much needed healing. Proverbs 17:22 says a cheerful heart is good medicine. I think a cheerful heart is not only good medicine, it can lead to laughter, which, as we know, is good for the body and the soul. A kindergarten teacher was walking around observing her classroom of children while they were drawing pictures. As she got to one little girl who was diligently drawing, she asked the girl, "What are you drawing?" And the girl replied, "I'm drawing God." The teacher paused and said, "But no one knows what God looks like." The little girl answered, "They will in a few minutes." The second Sunday of Easter builds on the good news we celebrated last Sunday. Jesus was dead and is now alive. The women went to the tomb in despair and they left in delight. It's quite a story, and though we may sometimes have questions about the details, one thing never changes. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Holy Humor Sunday continues the Easter celebration. It celebrates the fact that the resurrection of Jesus is God's ultimate joke on evil and death. It is a testament to the God who, as the psalmist proclaims, sits in the heavens and laughs at the foolishness of humanity and any forces that might seek to thwart God's will. Those any forces, by the way, include the evil one and any effort it makes to stop God from doing what God is going to do. Celebrations of Holy Humor Sunday are taking place in many churches today. Congregations across the United States and around the world are celebrating God's joke in new ways. I read about a Presbyterian church in New Bethlehem, Pennsylvania that is passing out the Good Humor Bars, which is where I got the idea, to everyone who came to church that day. Now, I don't know if this is true or not, but I heard that there's a church in Portland that is having clowns greet the members as they come in the door, and then the first song is going to be accompanied by kazoos. Well, you know, you can talk to Pastor Ben, maybe next year, eh? As today's passage begins, we find the disciples fearfully gathered behind closed doors. Suddenly, Jesus is in the room with them saying, "Shalom," which is often translated as, "Peace be with you," which is a legitimate translation. However, when Jesus says, "Shalom, peace be with you," he is saying more than what we sometimes think of as the definition of peace. When Jesus says, "Shalom, peace be with you," he is pronouncing a blessing over the people that who are hearing it. He's wishing them wholeness, completeness, all good things. And that word shalom is one that is used to this day as a blessing and a greeting. When someone says shalom, they are blessing you and wishing God's absolute best for you. It's a blessing, it's an announcement, it's a prayer that all will be well, that we will be at peace with our past, our present, and our future. I'm sure many of us here today have things in our past that we would rather not remember or think about. I know for me that is certainly true about my pre-sobriety days. While looking back is not a particularly bad thing, it can become a problem if we get stuck there, if we cannot move past what happened before. If we get stuck there, we might miss what is right in front of us. When Jesus says this one simple word, shalom, he's telling the disciples and us that we are forgiven of all of our past sins. Jesus' word, shalom, brings peace to our past. His shalom can also bring peace to our presence, our present. I want to ask you just a simple question. Where do you need peace in your life right now? All of us, I'm sure, can attest to the fact that life seems unmanageable at times. We heard a few things about that this morning. People who are dying, people who are injured, people who are struggling. And sometimes it's in our own inside us that we are searching for peace. We live in a broken world. The sad truth is we live in a broken world. People's lives are being challenged and torn apart every day. And at times, doesn't it feel like everything is just in total chaos? That there's not a place we can look that isn't somehow disrupted or disturbed or whatever? When Jesus says shalom, peace be with you, he's blessing us with the knowledge, with the prayer, with the blessing of peace that passes all understanding. As we age, we know about that, don't we? As life changes, as things get a little strange some days, we forget stuff. The other day I forgot how to tie my shoe. I mean, seriously, that was scary. For a few minutes there, I'm going, then I took a deep breath and thought about it. And I can't tell you exactly what happened. But all of a sudden, I had this sense of, it's okay, Linda. It's okay. It's only a shoelace. When Jesus says, shalom, peace be with you, no matter what is going on in our lives at that moment, peace is with us. Jesus' shalom can heal our present. We walk by faith, right? Not by sight. Because we know there is only one person qualified under heaven and earth to deal with the present realities that we have. Jesus' shalom speaks to our past and our present, but it also speaks to our future, the wholeness of our future. As today's passage continues, we hear about Thomas. Now Thomas, known as Didymus, or one of the twins, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand in his side, I will not believe." How many of you think of Thomas when you hear the name Thomas in this scripture? What's the title we give him?
Doubting
Thomas, right. I kind of think that's mean. The poor man, for one simple act in his life, he's been remembered now and always as Doubting Thomas. I mean, come on. Do we want to carry around a childhood nickname for the rest of us? No, not necessarily. So I thought it would be interesting to take a closer look at Thomas. So I went and I found in the 11th chapter of John, where Jesus had just been made aware of Lazarus' death. While the other disciples were moaning and groaning in fear of going back to Jerusalem, where they potentially could be killed, it was Thomas who spoke up and said, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." So how about fearless Thomas? And then in chapter 14 of John, Jesus and the disciples have gathered together for the Passover, and during the meal, Jesus is telling them what's going to happen to him. He's going to be tortured. He's going to be crucified. He's going to rise again. He had just finished telling them that he was going to go and prepare rooms for them. And what did they say? Thomas said, that are familiar to us today. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. So how about brave Thomas or honest Thomas? In today's passage, we do meet Thomas for the third time, and he simply could not believe what the others were saying. Jesus alive? No way. No way. Well, you know, in this particular case, doubting Thomas is appropriate. But, you know, there's a level of irony here. If you think about it, did Mary know Jesus was alive before she saw him? Before he said her name? Mm-hmm. And what about the disciples? They were in that room, fearfully gathered. Did they know? No, they were doubting as well. So why do we stick poor Thomas with the doubting Thomas label? Well, who knows? Speaking of doubt, you know what happens if we point a finger at someone else, right? Yeah, do it for just a moment. Point at the floor or something. So what happens when you point? There you go. Three fingers point back, right? Are there any among us who can say that we have never doubted our faith? Are there any among us who have ever been so overwhelmed with life that we have wondered if there really is a God? And if there is, does God really love me? I don't know about you, but I've certainly had moments like that. There may be this doubting thing. If you've ever doubted your faith, doubted God's love, I want to say to you, welcome to the human race. Welcome to the human race. Doubt is a feeling, right? Doubt is a feeling. And you know what is true about feelings? In the end, they don't really matter. It's faith that matters. And so when we doubt for a moment, it's okay. God understands. God doesn't leave us. God is still with us. God won't leave us just because we have a moment or two or six of doubt. Then Jesus said to Thomas, put your finger here in my hand. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Can you imagine the look on Thomas's face at that moment? Eyes about this big. Looking at Jesus, and without touching him, Thomas responds, my Lord and my God. Now Thomas is in on the joke too. The one who was dead is alive. The joke is on those who thought they had won. My favorite part of this passage is found in verse 29, where Jesus says, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Want to take a wild guess as to why it's my favorite? Because it's about us. It's about us. We don't have to see Jesus to believe. We don't have to see Jesus to be blessed. We believe without seeing. So here we are, a bunch of blessed people celebrating the gift of laughter, the gift of life everlasting. We are in on the joke. Christ has risen.
Christ has risen.
Okay, but not with some oomph. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
There we go. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Orange.
Orange you.
Aren't you glad that's my last knock, knock joke?
Thank you. Thank you, Bas Glinda. At this time, could you please stand if you're able as we continue worshiping God, singing Spirit of God from the Faith We Sing hymnal, 2117. And as you stand, could you turn to someone and say Shalom?
Shalom.
Your wings,
that's right. Either that or I should take the microphone with me, right?
Yeah.
Maybe I should do that?
Well,
you'll hear me. You can hear me if I use my outside voice, can't you?
Yeah.
Louder than your outside voice.
Louder than my outside voice.
Oh, there we are.
All right, now, may the Lord our God be with you.
And also with you.
And may you celebrate today with joy and laughter and humor, and maybe even pull the trick on someone. As long as it's not me, okay? May the Lord love you and hold you and be with you today and always. And all of God's children gather here together, say,
Shalom.
Amen.